And through youth ministry, God ministered to them and within their life. And so, Father, we pray over Alex, and we thank you for the word that you placed in his heart. And God, the word that's going to be delivered. Pray that it's a non-time word that would not only speak to us, but God, may it convict us as we know more about who you are in our lives and what you've done. And so, Lord, use them as we go into and finish off this series of I Do. We thank you in the name of the Father and of the Son, the Holy Spirit. And everybody says,
amen.
Let's put a clap off for you guys. God bless everybody this morning. Before I start, I just want to let you guys know that I am living proof of the purpose of God is real.
Amen.
That the purpose of God is real. And that without that, I have nothing. I can't be who I am called to be without that purpose, amen? Today I have the honor of speaking to you about I do what I am. You may be seated. I struggle with this message a little bit because I had to figure out what is it that I am, and I was reminded of the movie Batman Begins towards the end when he's talking to Katie Holmes and he says, it's not who I am underneath that defines me, but it's what I do. It's what I do. And I had to think about, you know, my journey through life and the things that I've done. And all I could think about was sin and addiction. But that's not what defines me. Sin isn't what defines you. What holds you back doesn't define you, church. It's what you do in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That defines you.
Amen.
And today's message is a message of declaration. And we'll go through four. And my first one is, I am redeemed. Redeem means to buy out or purchase or to be ransomed. In the book of John, chapter 8, verse 34, it says, Jesus is saying, very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. And I couldn't help but think of the analogy of the slave to the master. The slave obeys the master because he owns him. Slaves have no will of their own because they're literally in bondage. But a slave is redeemed when the price is paid for his freedom. You and I were once slaves to sin. But because of Jesus, and because of the love of God that he had for us, we are redeemed, church.
Amen.
We are redeemed. Our ransom was paid in full. Not partially, because sometimes we like to walk around like we were partially redeemed. And we like to kind of keep the chains that hold us as a decoration, as a silly cliche. But our price was paid in full.
Amen.
We are redeemed.
Amen.
In Romans 6:18, it says, you have been set free from sin, but it still talks about slavery, but not the same kind of slavery, because we become slaves to righteousness.
Amen.
And to be righteous, it's to be morally right or justifiable or free from guilt or sin. And to be righteous is to be like God. But it also has to be, you also have to be in the right relationship with God.
Right.
Because sometimes we like to serve the Jesus that just provides. Sometimes we just want to serve that Jesus that when we need him, he'll heal us. Or when I'm low on rent, that's when we want to get down on our knees and pray to God to deliver us. But you know what? That's not the full Jesus, church. That isn't the Jesus that we serve. And to be righteous, to be in that right relationship, you know what? It calls us to abide in the Word of God, to walk next to Christ. That's the position of that part. To be in the right relationship, because when you're in the right relationship and when you're walking next to Jesus side by side, you become a little more righteous. You become more justifiable. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, it says, "We seek first the kingdom and his righteousness." So don't you think it's important to abide? Stand firm in the Word of God.
Amen.
I said this months ago, that this here will lead you to forever. This here, the word of God, will lead you to eternity.
Amen.
But we got to be in the right relationship. Amen?
Amen?
My next point is I am a disciple. The disciple we know is a follower or student of the teacher. But we know that we are the students of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is our teacher. And I can't help but think that one of his greatest teachings of being a servant, I think that's key for discipleship, is to be a servant.
Amen.
And the greatest teaching that he gave about that is in John chapter 13, verses 4 and 5, and 14 and 15. And the scripture says that Jesus got up from the table, took off his robe, then wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin, and began to wash the feet of the disciples. And then he dried them with the towel that was around his waist. I couldn't help but think that there's the position that Jesus was in. So I gotta show you. It says that he was sitting on the table and he took off his robe. So this here will represent the robe. I was a slave to this time, I am redeemed, except for you. The position of being a servant is to be on your knees. Because to serve and to really teach people about Christ, sometimes we can't be on the level. We gotta be on our knees, right?
Amen, amen.
So it says that he began to wash his feet, the feet of the disciples. The towel that he used was around his waist. And I couldn't help but think that the disciples, they wore sandals. They wore no Jordans, they wore no Nikes. So their feet were nothing but exposed to just dirt, just pure nastiness. I'm like, this man got on the level of a slave to wash the feet of his followers. And I couldn't help but think that, you know what, as a disciple, we're going to encounter people that walk some dirty paths. We're going to encounter some people that just keep walking in some messed up stuff.
Amen. Reach.
But because we are servants, and because we are redeemed, and because we live the righteous life, we can be the reflection of Christ.
Hallelujah.
Fourth one. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. In the New King James Version, in Psalms 139, verses 13 to 14, it says, "For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well." In the Hebrew, the word fearfully means with great reverence, heartfelt interest and respect, and wonderfully means unique and set apart and marvelous. And I couldn't help but think, no wonder David was so excited when you read this, because he understood that he was set apart and created in the image of the ever-living God,
Amen.
The God that we serve.
Amen.
So then, us knowing this, why do we wake up in the morning and look in the mirror and just point out our faults? I don't like the way my hair looks. Why did the Lord bless me with all this? I pray victim. I'm like, Lord, why did you have to blossom the hair on the top of my head? I feel fearful, not wonderful. What's going on? But it's the truth. But you know what? Sometimes it stems further than that. Sometimes when it comes, because when we're called to serve, we're hesitant. Because you know what, God? I don't feel fit to serve. I don't feel fit to be in ministry. I don't think I can fit that part. But church, we are fearfully and wonderfully made, set apart. We're set apart because God intended us to feel that way, to feel in ministry, to serve, to be a disciple. In verse 13, it says that he formed us. Formed in Hebrew means to fashion or to mold. And I couldn't help but think of God being the potter. And do you mind if I just throw it in reverse to the Old Testament real quick? In Jeremiah chapter 18, where he tells Jeremiah to go into the potter's house. And when he walks in, he sees the potter just sitting there. And the wheel's going, he's spinning, and he's molding us. God molds us, church.
Amen.
He molds us into his perfect image.
Amen.
So I couldn't help but think, God doesn't make junk. God doesn't create garbage. The perception of what's out there, all the garbage that feeds inside us, that's what changes our perspective. That's why it's hard to believe that I am perfect in God's image. Because God didn't create junk. God is the potter. We are his clay. And he doesn't make junk. He is intentional about the way that he forms us. And I couldn't help but think of intentional means purpose. But didn't God say in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, that I know the plans for you, a plan to prosper you, a plan to lift you up?
That's right.
Pottery is made by forming a clay body into objects of a required and intentional shape, heating them at a high temperature in a kiln, which removes all the water from the clay, which induces reactions that lead to permanent change. Sometimes God has to turn the heat up in our lives to strengthen us, to make us hard. If not, with that silly old mug that when we open the cabinet, it just falls in shadows. But God didn't build us like that. Because when God turns up the heat, you see, when God turns up the heat, we're quick to say, oh man, I don't know if I can make it through this situation. I'm not strong enough. But we don't realize that the situations that God put us in aren't to destroy us, but to build us up and take us to the next level that he has in the purpose of our lives. So we wake up in the morning and start to think of the negative flaws that we see in the mirror. It should be a declaration of an affirmity that I am fearfully and wonderfully made, church. And I'm going to close with this. In John chapter 19, verse 30, it says, when he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. When I was doing the research online, it said the Greek meaning for finished is tetelestai. But in Greek, it was a word for accounting. And it means paid in full. Our ransom was paid in full. Our ransom was paid in full. We are no longer held captive by sin. And we are able to receive righteousness through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I couldn't help but think on my way here, and my wife, she kind of makes a face now because I kind of burned it out. But the direction of our lives, man, that's why I love this church. Because when you're going in the wrong direction and you come to the point where you need to turn around, you got to make a U-turn. So I get into the turning lane and she would say, I got to make a U-turn. I'm like, oh, it's okay. God allows this. We're going in the wrong direction, but then we come to the point of the cross. We come to the point of the cross, church. We come to the point of the cross, church. We come to the point of the cross, church. We find the redemption, and we learn that we are redeemed. We are no longer held captive in the direction where we're going, but we're making the U-turn. You may have came here this morning. Not feeling perfect, not feeling created in the image of God. You don't feel like a disciple. You don't care for serving. And you don't feel like you've been redeemed. But I'm here to tell you God's already taking care of it. But this morning needs to be a morning of like declaration. This morning needs to be a morning of declaration. Not, I think I'm redeemed. I think God was doing something right when he made me. I don't know. Because it's the truth. You know, we feel messed up. All said and disgusted. I tell the Torah from the Torah, but sometimes it makes us want to throw up. But just like Jesus did for the disciples, he's here to meet you where you're at, man. Can we come on our knees as well? Meet the Creator face to face. I read this story that there was this kindergarten teacher, and she gave a project to her classmates. So, draw whatever you want. So she's checking up on her students. Got kids drawing trees, kids drawing fire trucks. And she gets to this little girl, and the teacher says, "Becky, what is that you're drawing?" She's like, "I'm drawing the face of Jesus." And she says, "Becky, no one knows what he looks like." "It's okay, because when I'm done, they're going to know what he looks like." I wasn't trying to share a joke, but it just happened. Are we righteous enough? So people see the face of Jesus in our lives.